let's look at a heating curve for water. So let's look at the process as we heat something from ice through the liquid phase and to the steam or the vapor phase. Before we get into the problem, let's look at a couple of definitions. First, specific heat. This is going to be the amount of energy in kilojoules that is required to increase 1 gram of a sample, in this case water, by 1 degree Celsius. So if we have a sample of ice, say we have a 10 gram sample of ice, and we want to heat that up, we're going to have to know what the specific heat of ice is. And in this case, ice is going to be 2.09 joules per gram per degree Celsius. So that means it's going to take 2.09 joules for every gram of ice to increase the temperature by 1 degree Celsius. Different states of matter have different values for specific heat. So we already looked at the one for ice. The specific heat of water is 4.184 joules per gram per degree Celsius. And for steam, it's 2.03 joules per gram per degree Celsius. So this is the value for the amount of energy required to raise 1 gram of water or ice or steam by 1 degree Celsius. Another definition we need to look at is the heat of fusion, and we're going to have another one called the heat of vaporization that we're going to look at in a minute. But the heat of fusion is going to be the energy that's required to convert 1 gram of ice at 0 degrees Celsius to water at 0 degrees Celsius. And so that value for water is 334 joules per gram. And notice that we don't have a degree Celsius component in that number, because during the process of heating, the energy is going directly into the ice and converting it to the water, but we are not experiencing a temperature change during this process. Just like for fusion, for vaporization, there is a heat of vaporization, and that is going to be the amount of heat that's required to convert 1 gram of water at 100 degrees Celsius to the vapor phase at 100 degrees Celsius. And so the heat of vaporization for water is going to be 2,263 joules per gram. Okay, so let's look at, as we go from ice at minus 20 to steam at positive 120 degrees Celsius, what are the changes that are going to take place? So starting off down here at minus 20, we're going to heat the ice. That energy is going to go towards a temperature change in the ice. And so we can calculate that using the specific heat of the ice. Once we reach 0 degrees Celsius, the energy that is going into the ice does not increase the temperature. Instead, what it does is it converts it from ice into the liquid water. Once all of that has been completed, so during that process, there is no temperature change. So this is going to remain at 0 degrees Celsius until all of the ice has completed the transition. Once the ice has completed the transition, we're going to increase the temperature of the liquid water according to the specific heat of liquid water. And so that change is going to continue until the water reaches 100 degrees Celsius. Once the water reaches 100 degrees Celsius, the energy that goes into the water goes to transform it from a liquid state into the vapor phase. And so we can calculate that using the heat of vaporization. And then once all of the vapor has been, or all of the water has been converted into vapor, then we can use the specific heat of the vapor, the steam, to increase the temperature of the steam to 120 degrees Celsius. Okay, so let's look at a problem here. We've got how much energy is required to convert 10 grams of ice at minus 20 to steam at positive 120 degrees Celsius. I've written down all the conversions that we're going to need. And so for this particular problem, we're going to have 5 steps. And the first step is going to be involving this transition right down here. So it's going to be from minus 20 to 0 degrees Celsius. So for that step, what we're going to do is we're going to take our 10 grams of ice, we're going to multiply that times the specific heat of the ice, which is 2.09 joules per gram per degree Celsius, and then we're going to multiply it by the temperature change, which in this case is going to go from minus 20 to 0, so that's going to be a 20 degree change in temperature. And so we're going to multiply all that out, and so we get 418 joules for that step. Step 2 is going to be to convert the 10 grams of ice into water. And so for that, we're going to use the delta H, the heat of fusion, which is 2.09 joules per gram. So we're going to take our 10 grams and we're going to multiply that by 2.09 joules per gram. You can see here grams is going to cancel. And so for that one, we're going to get 20.9 joules for that step. Third step, convert 10 grams of water at 0 degrees Celsius to water at 100 degrees Celsius. So for that one, we're going to take our 10 grams of water. We're going to multiply by the specific heat of water, which is 4.184 joules per gram per degree Celsius. The temperature change to go from 0 to 100 degrees Celsius is going to be 100 degrees. So we're going to put 100 degrees Celsius there. So the answer for this one is going to be 4,184 joules for that step. Step 4, convert our 10 grams of water into 10 grams of steam. So for that, we're going to need the enthalpy of vaporization, so the delta H vap. We're going to do 10 grams times 2,263 joules per gram. And that is going to give us 22,630 joules for step 4. Step 5 is going to be converting 10 grams of steam from 100 degrees Celsius to 120 degrees Celsius. And so for that step, we're going to use our specific heat of steam. So we're going to do 10 grams times 2.03 joules per gram per degree Celsius. And then we're going to multiply by the temperature change, which is going to be from 100 to 120. So that's going to be 20 degrees Celsius. And so our final answer is 406 joules. So now we have 5 answers. We actually have answer from step 1, which was 418 joules. We have our answer from step 2, 20.9 joules. Step 3, 4,184. Step 4, 22,630. And then 406. So our total, if we add all those up, our total becomes 27,659 joules, or 27.7 kilojoules. So the process we just described is a lot of steps. And depending on the problem that you're given, you may or may not need all of these steps. So for example, if you were doing water from, say, 10 degrees Celsius to 40 degrees Celsius, then you would only need one step. You would only need the step where you take the specific heat of water and multiply that times your sample mass times the change in temperature. If you are changing phases, you're going to have to account for the enthalpy of fusion, the enthalpy of vaporization, whatever the phase change is. Also, it's worth noting that as you increase the temperature and therefore boil the liquid or melt it, that is an endothermic process, so that requires an input of energy. The opposite process, going from a hotter temperature to a cooler temperature, is going to be exothermic. That is going to release energy.